Second reading this morning is from the New Testament book of 1 Thessalonians. This is the earliest book in the New Testament to have been written. We think that Paul wrote this letter to the church at Thessalonica around the year 50 or 51. They were about one generation away at that point from Jesus' ascension. The tone in this letter is consistently positive. Now, in most of Paul's letters, there is a problem that he is dealing with, and sometimes there is a problem group that he's dealing with, so his letters are not always real warm and fuzzy. But this one really is. I mean, from the beginning to the end, Paul is just, he's so clearly trying to support and uphold this congregation in Thessalonica. It seems that there was a concern that they had that got back to Paul. He had preached to them that Jesus was coming back, and they certainly expected that. But enough time had passed now that some of their congregation were dying. And so the concern arose, would there be any disadvantage to those loved ones who had died when Jesus returned? And so in the passage just before the one for today, Paul says, no concern at all. He says, when it happens, there will be the trumpet of the Lord, and Jesus will appear on the clouds, and those who have died in Christ will rise and meet him in the crowds, and we will be there too. But the ones who died will actually go first. So he says, don't worry about that. Everything is going to be fine when it finally happens. And so then he continues with something similar thoughts, but a little bit of modulation in our passage for today. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, 1 through 11. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then, let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who are drunk, get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. The word of the Lord. So Paul has just told them what it will be like when Jesus does return. But he then goes right on to say, I know you're probably thinking about when, but I don't have to tell you when, because you already know what there is to know. I've already taught you about the when. And that is that nobody knows when it will be. When Jesus comes, it will be just as surprising as it will be to a householder when a thief comes in the middle of the night. The thief does not give warning. The thief does not ring any alarm bells. The thief comes, and there he is. And so the same will be true of Jesus. The surprise is the important point about this part of the passage. When they say there is peace and security, security, then sudden destruction will come upon them. I'm not really sure who the they is here. The they could be the sort of Greco-Roman culture in which the Christians in Thessalonica find themselves, immersed in that larger imperial culture. It was the slogan of Rome at that time that there is peace and security with Rome. We've all heard of the Pax Romana, the Roman peace. So maybe Paul was saying, they may think that it's peace, but Jesus will come to judge, and then it will happen. It will surprise them. And when it begins, there is no way to stop it. I think that's his reference to the woman in labor. Once it begins, it has to go all the way through to completion. It sounds a little scary to us, maybe, the idea of judgment coming when we least expect it. And certainly there have been many preachers and many writers who use a passage like this to instill fear in people's hearts. How many billboards have you seen along the highway? You know, Jesus is coming. Are you ready? If you die tonight, would you go to heaven or hell? You know, those kinds of things. But I don't think Paul is trying to scare the people with this passage. This is all about comfort. He's telling them that when it happens, they don't have anything to worry about. You are children of the light, he says. That's who you are. That is your identity. You've already been brought into that community of light. When the day of the Lord comes, it will feel very natural to you because you are already living in the light. So, he comforts them. He says, that's who you are. You don't have anything to worry about. But then he goes on with some instruction. Since that's who you are, then this is how you ought to live. You ought to live as a child of the light. And he tells them what that is all about. It's tempting to think of categories of people. You read a passage like this and you think to yourself, well, I'm a child of the light. People in my church are children of the light. But what about those other people out there? Who are the people who are children of the darkness, children of the night? We have this tendency, don't we, to want to draw lines. I think there the insights of the great theologian Karl Barth are very helpful. He says, really, even for Christians, sometimes we find ourselves falling away, and we have to come back to the light. It's a constant process, he says. Christians are people who have been waked up by God. We've waked up. We smell the coffee. We look around and we see what the world is really like. We see the world in light of God's great love, in light of God's plans for salvation and remaking all of the hurts of the world, smoothing them, undoing the pain, making the world right again. As Christians, we know that that's what's coming. We have been waked up to that. But Barth says, we have to keep waking up because we have a tendency to fall away. We have a tendency to go back to sleep sometimes, and we need to be reminded to wake up always. It's like conversion. Conversion is not something that happens just once and then it's over with. Conversion is something that we continue to go through our entire life. So maybe it's best that we not try to identify who the children of darkness are, because sometimes maybe they are us. We just need to do our best always to wake up and live as children of the light. Paul says that we are helped in this because we have armor. We have armor against that darkness that tries to impinge on our lives. We have, just like he said in the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians, we have faith, and we have hope, and we have love. They are our breastplate. They are our helmet, our defensive weapons that help keep away the darts of the dark one and the darkness. The darkness is dangerous. Paul does not minimize that, but he says you have what you need. You have the armor that will allow you to turn away those darts if only you will rely on it. And don't worry about God's wrath, which of course is justified against this world. Don't worry about that, because God is not destined you for wrath, but for salvation. Do not worry. Be comforted. Christ died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. There's a possibility for confusion here, because Paul has just talked about the people who are asleep, the ones who find themselves in the land of darkness. I don't think Paul is saying that it doesn't make any difference whether you're in the light or in the darkness. I think now he's going back to the usage that he had earlier in chapter 4, where he says, where he thinks of people who are alive as being awake and people who have died as being asleep. So he's going back to his original point. Don't worry whether you are alive or whether you are dead. You are living with Jesus. You are living with So, now, the main point of the whole passage. Therefore, he says, in light of everything that I have just told you, therefore, what do you do? You encourage one another and build up each other, as in fact you are doing. So Paul says, once we know that our eternal salvation is assured, once we know what Jesus has done for us, then what's left is for us to encourage each other. And what great advice that is. What good advice it was for the people in Thessalonica, because some of them were worried. Their fellow church members could encourage them and build them up and remind them about the truths of the Christian life. What about in our congregation? I see you all the time building each other up, taking care of each other, encouraging each other. I got a call last night from one of you telling me that there has been an illness in the congregation. I didn't make sure I knew about it so that I could be a part of comforting the family. It's something that you do instinctively. You share that kind of information that helps us take care of one another. What a good rule for us as we try to live together as church members, that we always try to build one another up. We can't go it alone. One of us can't make a church. We have to have each other. So, you know, look to your right. Look to your left. These are the people that you're with. These are your brothers and sisters. These are the ones that you need to help, and these are the ones you can depend upon when you need them. We should talk to each other in ways that build one another up as Christians. I just read a management text that said that for every criticism you offer as a manager, you should think of 5 compliments. The criticism needs to be constructive, first of all, but even when it's constructive, it needs to be embedded in lots of affirmation. Because people often take the criticisms to heart much more readily than they can accept the fact of the good things that they're doing. So we have to overcompensate by telling people, just how good they are, just how much we love them, just how much we appreciate them and everything they're trying to do for the church. That's a really good rule, I think, from the world of management that we could use in church. When we're making plans for the future, it's becoming the fashion in churches these days not to think about what we're doing wrong that needs to be changed. That's one way to approach making plans for the future. But there's this sort of new thing called appreciative inquiry. And so when you do that, here's the question you ask. Not what is wrong, but when we were at our best, what were we doing? That tells you what is the heart of the congregation. When have they really felt like the Spirit of God was moving them, was animating their plans and their actions? When they really felt that they were being church, when was that in the life of the congregation? If we can capture that moment and remember it, then we can replicate it. We can keep doing it. We can make our plans for the future. So, we have faith, we have hope, and we have love, and we build each other up as a congregation. We are for each other just as Jesus Christ is for us. I appreciate you, and I hope you appreciate each other. You are a wonderful